This was Ethiopia last October, a refugee camp in the province of Wollo. There were 13 such camps. It was not until October that the outside world learned of the catastrophe of the unknown famine. In the camps of Wollo, there's been a transformation. On the same ground where last October children lay at the point of death, they study now at school. These are the children of Mercer Camp, children who are alive now because the people of the world outside came to their rescue, sending doctors and nurses, paying for medicine and food. Had help not arrived, then many of these children, like their brothers and sisters before them, would now be dead. There is no shortage of relief now for the camps of Wollo. Like Mercer, like the 12 other camps in the province, Desi has been transformed. In October last year, more than 20 men, women and children died each day in Desi camp. Now one, or perhaps two, die each week. In October, the 500 children here had as their first meal of the day one cup of weak tea. They were wasting away. Now they have high-protein milk. Special foods have arrived from Britain, Ireland, the United States, Finland, and the common market. It is not hard to treat starving children. The cure is food. In October, this health officer ran Desi camp on his own. He predicted then that if supplies did not arrive from the outside world within a month, one third of the children here would die. The supplies did arrive.
If we take these two children.
These two?
These two.
Still crying.
They were emaciated, yeah. Skinny, and very weak. But now they have improved, and she has also got her normal weight, and she's
quite a healthy child.
Yes, she is healthy now. But last time, she was almost skin and bone.
She was here last time.
Yes, she was here.
And if she hadn't had the treatment and the medication and the food, would she have died?
Yes, yes. She was a miserable infant, almost malnourished. And she had been in the intensive feeding ward.
Is she typical of a lot of children here?
Yes, she is. She is.
Last October, this sick ward was grotesquely overcrowded. The dead lay undiscovered amongst the dying. There was not one doctor in the camp. That too has changed. By the beginning of this year, there were 10 doctors here, some from Britain, some from Ethiopia. There were nurses, dressers, orderlies. Some will still die, but they too receive care and attention. To transform the camps is not to end the crisis. ...400 miles away in the capital city of Ethiopia, Addis Ababa, there's been transformation and crisis too. In the last 3 weeks, Ethiopia has experienced a political upheaval. There's been a revolt by the army, the first general strike, the collapse of a government which has been in power for 30 years. In this political convulsion, the famine played a leading part. Each week since November, the government's emergency committee has met to coordinate the relief operation. The ministries represented here must take much of the blame for the deaths from starvation last year. Ministers like Malatu Dubebe did nothing for too long. When they finally sought help, they asked too quietly for too little, and it was too late. They had been warned. The Ministry of Agriculture reported 6 months in advance that the spring of 1973 would bring famine to Ethiopia. The government suppressed the report. In the Ministry of the Interior, some knew and kept quiet. Others suspected, but did not bother to discover what was happening in the land they administered. The Ministry of Information, with the ignorance, indifference, and pride of the Ethiopian ruling elite, failed to alert the world and consciously hid the disaster from its own people. By the end of last year, that had changed utterly. Secrecy and indifference had given way to openness and urgency. In the last 3 months, the government has devised the machinery and plans to tackle the famine, but this change came too late to save the government. On the same day that the Emperor of Ethiopia, the father of Africa, Haile Selassie, arrived to open the 22nd session of his beloved Organization of African Unity, his entire government resigned. After more than 40 years of power, the emperor's feudal regime was at the point of collapse. Because of the famine, last October, the emperor's regime stood under the hostile spotlight of the world for the first time. In Ethiopia itself, the people saw the disaster as evidence of their government's incompetence. Though there were other causes too, the drought fueled the fires of the country's political crisis. Ethiopia's future is uncertain, but the battle against the famine goes on. Ethiopia is not the only country in Africa devastated by famine. This year, as last year, a vast belt stretching across the continent is affected. This year, it is worse than last year. In Ethiopia, the drought now affects half the country, the south as well as the north. It is possible that 4 million people are now suffering from famine in Ethiopia. In the province of Wollo alone, 1 million people still face starvation. They're kept from it by an emergency operation based on the provincial capital, Dessie. The operation is spearheaded by the Germans, flying deep into the interior with doctors, nurses, and emergency supplies. There are now more than 30 international agencies in Wollo. Help has arrived from Britain, from Europe, from the United States, from China, from Africa, Canada, Australia, and South America. Altogether, more than £15 million has been committed in aid to Ethiopia. It will all be needed. The full extent of the catastrophe in Wollo is only now becoming apparent. It was the German helicopters flying over deserted farmland, empty of animals, bare of crops, which proved that the worst fears were justified. It was the helicopters which discovered that village after village was wholly deserted. No one will ever know exactly what happened in Wollo province last year. How many fled to the towns in search of food? How many never arrived? How many stayed behind to die? Whole communities have perished. In this part of Wollo, there are no roads. For many of those who remained in the interior last year and survived, their first evidence of outside civilization has been the helicopter. These peasants, for long ignored and forgotten, have never before received attention of any kind. They are now wholly dependent on relief. When the Germans first arrived, their food and medicine saved hundreds of lives. In the last 3 months, helicopter teams have brought these peasants back to a precarious normality. Now, because of the cost and the difficulties of operation, the helicopters are due to leave at the end of the month. In this village, 300 patients wait each day for attention at the new clinic. At first, the teams dealt with starvation. Now, they treat the everyday diseases of this part of Africa. Diseases which give the Ethiopian an average life expectancy of 35 years.
Winnie, what can you say to her? She has not always moved her hand, otherwise I'll make three times, five times.
The question now is whether this invasion of foreign medical skill will mark the beginning of a new era. Will this forgotten world continue to get this basic medical care? Or, when the foreigners move out, will the Ethiopian government forget again? But the future is not only a matter of medicine. The villagers of Wallo are amongst the poorest in the world. Even in good times, the peasants are pressed by absentee landlords demanding half their crop in rent, live from hand to mouth. Without land reform and new farming techniques, the families which exist in these remote villages will live in constant crisis. Now, these people have no crops. Their animals have died. If they do not soon get the seed and oxen the government plans to give them, their future will be like their past. The elders of the village will witness the final collapse of their community.
Some
1,060 people have died.
Just in this area?
Just in this area. And almost half. People have died, they say. Very, you know.
Is this the first time that this has happened to these people?
This is the first time. Until this camp was created, five, six people died every day. And they buried about five persons in one grave.
What do they think about the future now?
Depending on the government. They're only waiting for what the government is going to do for them. They say we only pray to Allah, to God, and accept that we are sorry for what has happened to us. There is nothing that we can do.
In Wallo, it is not merely the mountains and valleys which are affected. East of the highlands, stretching for more than 400 miles towards the sea, is the Danakil Desert, the eastern tip of that huge belt of Africa struck by the famine. 250 miles from Desi lies the outpost of Sado, in the middle of the desert. Sado looks out over a dead land. This is the territory of the Danakil tribesmen. The nomads of the desert have become refugees in their own land. Now, after 4 years of drought, the existence of an entire race is in jeopardy. Each year has been worse than the one before. The people now have nothing save the relief that is beginning to arrive from the outside world. These refugees have lost their cattle, their sheep, their goats and their camels. There's been no food, and now there is almost no water. Now, in the desert, people die not only from starvation, but from thirst. Almost all these graves in Sado have appeared in the last 6 months. It's feared that almost half the nomadic population of the Danakil Desert has perished in the famine. In the desert and in the mountains, the need is for water. Water for crops, water for animals, and water for people. The water here, as elsewhere, is a menace. A simple hand pump driven into the bottom of the pool, the work of 2 days, would save scores of lives each year. At the moment, this water is a source of disease and death. There is little point in giving a man grain one day if bad water is to kill him the next day. But relief workers cannot merely fit a pump. They have to explain to those who will use it why it is needed.
Often people die and you don't know why they die. And you are very sad about it. But the sicknesses that makes people to die, that's very little animals. You cannot see them with your eyes. But they are there. These little animals, they get in your body and they cause you to get sick. And we must separate that bad water from the good water that comes out of the spring. So that you will stay healthy.
And
that's the reason why we want to put that pump into your pool down there.
The plan is eventually approved. One pump in one pool in one corner of Wallo. It is, though, a beginning. In the middle of the interior, 8,000 feet up on the side of a mountain, 2,000 men are building a road by hand. The purpose is to open up Wallo to the outside world. The program's organized by the British Army, men of the Royal Engineers. It's the most dramatic and possibly the most important relief work of all. The men, refugees from the camps and the interior, work not for money, but for food, for 6 pounds of corn each day. No formal surveys been made, no technical instruments, no mechanical tools are used. It is a road built by men. Throughout Wallo, 8,000 men are cutting new road into the interior. The peasants work with the urgency of those who know that their lives depend on it. They've moved so fast that in 3 months they will probably build over 200 miles of new road through the mountains. In Wallo, the new roads are a revolution. For the first time, medicine, education and ideas will reach the interior. The local chiefs and landlords, sensing their power threatened, may not like it, but the future of the peasants can be transformed. For the moment, the new roads serve an immediate need. Where the road goes, food can follow. There are supposed to be 70 grain distribution centres dotted through Wallo. Less than half of them are in operation. The rest are still inaccessible. The governor of Wallo sought the help of the army to transport and distribute grain in November. The army arrived 3 months later. The emperor had to intervene before 200 men of the army's airborne division arrived in Wallo to help. They are highly efficient, but they are here for 1 month only. When they go, they will take with them their 40 lorries. If these are not replaced and more added, then there will be another catastrophe in Wallo. More than 100 trucks are needed to transport the grain to keep the people alive. There are not enough trucks available inside Ethiopia. Unless more arrive, people will starve this summer. For the moment, in those centres which are open, grain is being given. It is a desperately slow process. These people are now wholly dependent on the Ethiopian government and the outside world. They will be in this state at least until Christmas. For most of 1973, the famine was unknown. When the people of the world heard of it, they responded. By 1974, aid had reached Ethiopia. Food had arrived. More is promised. The question now is, can it reach the people? These people, at one feeding center in Wallo, form a tiny part of those throughout the province, throughout Ethiopia, who still face starvation. If, in the next few months, food does not reach the interior more quickly, then many will die. This year will be like last year. The lives of the men, women, and children of Ethiopia are once more in danger.